Hello and welcome. My name is Steve Sexton. I'm your host of the Silver Hair Tsunami Show. You know what? With over 100 million people over the age of 50, that means the baby boomers and above, you know what? We're all about helping you, getting you the information you need to know in order to manage the changing tides of retirement. Now, on today's show, we have Steve Rogers, best-selling author, speaker, knows Brian Tracy, Warren Buffett, and many others. He's a wonderful guest. You'll like him. We have Paula Shaw. She's going to talk about things like plastic surgery, sugar, alcohol, many other things, not what you think. And we have Glen and Shannon. The major reason why people sell their homes and get a great price for it is marketing, and they're going to talk to you about marketing. So stick with us. We'll be right back. On today's tip of the day, we're talking about the British exit from the European Union. This is a very significant historical event because they've been part of the European Union for 60 years. And it's scaring a lot of people. They're not sure how it's going to affect the stock market, the whole shot. You know, right now there's some positive things that are coming of it. We see low interest rates. So if you're looking at refinancing, this might be the opportune time to do that. Secondly, don't go nuts over what's happening. If you're young, I'm talking if you're still in those accumulation years all the way up to mid-50s, this is actually a good time because if the market goes down, you could buy more and accumulate for when you need it. If you're getting close to retirement, you should have a plan in place with your financial advisor to reduce and eliminate risks that you're not comfortable with. Good rule of thumb, if you can't sleep at night, take some money off the table. That means take some money out of the market. Now, last but not least, if you're in retirement, you should have a certain portion of your assets that aren't subject to market risk. You should have a portion that are subject to market risk. And you want to make sure you're comfortable with all that. So you know what? That's the tip of the day. Don't panic. Stick around. We'll be back with you in a moment. Hey, welcome back. This is Steve Sexton. You know, this next segment is wonderful, especially if you're looking to sell your home. You know what? One of the biggest things about selling your home is marketing. All too often, realtors just put your listing on the multiple listing service, and you know what? It gets shown up at one place, and that's it. But there's many other ways to market your home, and the reality is if you don't do it right, your house might not sell for a year or so, and we don't want that, especially in a market where prices are up, especially if you're looking to sell. That's why we have Glen and Shannon of the Alliance Group. They're here to tell us all about how to market a home. Welcome.
Thanks, Steve. Thanks for having us.
Thanks for having us here. That's great. Sorry, we're having fun today. Yep. So tell us about how do you go about marketing a home? What's important about it? What does it mean to the person who's selling their home? What does it mean to the people who are buying the home?
And you said it perfectly. As far as a big misconception or what happens a lot of time with real estate is an agent thinks all realtors are the same, all that happens, sign goes in the front yard, property goes on the MLS, and buyers are just going to show up at the home. Granted, you're going to get some buyers that way, but if you really want to maximize the exposure and you order, and the way you're going to get the highest price is getting as many people through the home. So that's where the marketing really comes into play with that. And that's one of the things we always talk about is there's the passive agents and then there's the active marketing. And the passive's the sign in the MLS where we actively are going out trying to find the ideal buyer or the target buyer for your property. So if you have the 3-bedroom, 2-bath home up in Poway, we know the demographic of buyer. It's most likely going to be a family. Children, school district is going to be important. So we need to make sure not only is our marketing reaching as many people as possible, but we need to be reaching that demographic too. We need to be reaching the families. We need to be reaching the move-up buyers. We need to be reaching that buyer that's most likely going to be moving into your home.
Okay, so what you're really saying is, hey, I need to find somebody this home's going to be a perfect fit for.
Yeah.
So how do I go about finding that somebody who's going to be the perfect fit?
Yeah. And there's so many different mediums that we use with our marketing to really maximize the exposure. And everything we start with the neighborhood and the community. You know, so print and mail notifying that there's a new listing or a new property coming on. Calling around the neighborhood and the community. You know, the community outreach with different networking groups and different things like that. Our database of realtors, our database of buyers. And then, of course, we use print, so that can be print in the local newspaper for the community. It could be Union Tribune, but the different mediums of print in order to get in front of course, we do the TV. So there's different opportunities on TV to be able to feature the properties. And of course, internet is gonna be the biggest area with that too, because it's over 94% of buyers now go online before when they start their home search, and that's what they're using to find their next property.
Now, one of the things that I look at is, you know what, I'm on your Facebook because you're on here as an expert. And I see you listing homes there with the tours.
Yeah.
So you can actually tour the whole home if you're just looking at your Facebook.
Yeah, it's a great medium for that. We've been having so much success in putting out the videos and actually showing the features of the property, like Glenn was saying, and can use that demographic in order to, the demographic we know is going to purchase that property, and use the video and the write-up and such to capture them.
So I thought it was really cool because, you know, you can talk about the school district. Somebody goes, hey, this is a great school district. Oh, look at this home. It fits what we're looking for. Let's look at inside. You know, it allows them to get that curb appeal before they actually go to the curb.
Yeah. And that one of the new, which you saw, one of the new technologies that we're using is it gives somebody the ability to walk through your home from their smartphone, their tablet, or their computer, where it's an actual 3D, you click, and it's just like using Google Maps, but you're walking through the home. So you can click up, down, look through the whole property. Only thing you can't do is open a drawer or a cabinet, but otherwise you can walk through the entire property.
You can even go to a window and look outside and see what the view would be from that particular vantage point.
Oh, wow, that's really cool. Yeah. So that really gives you an idea of what you're looking out, what type of view you're gonna have if you're overlooking a hill and the whole shot, or if you wanna look at San Diego. Yeah, I mean, does it allow you to dip your foot in the pool or anything like that?
No, not yet.
We haven't quite made it there.
But they're working on it.
You can make that happen. We're in. Now, how do people go get connected with the Alliance group to see that, like on Facebook? Do they go to your Facebook? How do they do that?
Yeah. So Facebook, we always utilize Facebook as one of our medians or one of the channels that we're marketing our properties. Our Facebook's Facebook, then My Alliance group. So we always feature our properties on there. Online, our website is Alliance Group. RE.com with that, or glennandshannon.com.
Now, one of the things before we finish is I really want to make our viewers very clear about this, because you know what, I have seen and had clients as a financial professional come to me talking about their frustration with their realtor and how the home hasn't sold in so long and it's an upmarket, they have to lower the price, all that kind of stuff. If somebody has the proper marketing, they could be in a position where you see 30, 40, 50 people go through the house within a very short period of time.
Yeah.
And then that brings to the next part where it becomes a negotiation, which means you have leverage on the negotiation because you have five or six people who want the house.
Yeah.
So obviously, four of them are going to drop out because they can't pay that much or don't want to, but you're always going to have that one that pays more. And that's just because you've created the demand for the house, and you're doing that through marketing.
That's exactly it. So, and that's where we're at. And just last week, we put a property on. We've driven over, had over 50 different parties through the property. And we had the conversation with our client this morning, and we're reviewing six different offers on the property. And so that's exactly where you mentioned. Now, our client and our seller is in the position of power because we're negotiating the price up. We have six different buyers that are all interested in the property, so we're really able to push the price to that upper limit. And you know, some I know won't work out, but there are going to be the two or three that will, and then that's going to give our seller the opportunity to really maximize what they're going to be walking away with at the end of the sale.
Puts them in the best negotiating position when we have more than one offer to work with at that point. And that's where the marketing really plays into that, Steve.
So if you're just somebody looking to sell your house, the important thing here is to understand what the realtor is going to do from a marketing standpoint. It's just not put it on a website, put up a sign, and hopefully people will show up. If you want to sell it quicker and you want to sell it at a higher price or the best possible price, you're going to need to have somebody that's going to do the print marketing, the email marketing, the Facebook marketing, all the different types of marketing. You talked about seven or eight of them.
Yeah.
So if you don't do them all, your house won't sell that much or that quickly or for that much.
Yeah,
so thank you for being here. I mean, shedding this light for people is just gigantic because it allows them to, you know, get more out of their house, live a quality of life that they want because they do get more out of their house. Hey, thank you for being on the show.
Oh, thank you.
Thanks
Steve.
For having us, Steve.
You know what? You want to stick with us. We're going to be right back. That was a wonderful segment with Glenn and Shannon. Hello, welcome back. You know what? Great guest. Number one best-selling author on Amazon. His name is Steve Rogers, who wrote this wonderful book called Lead to Gold. And he's a lifestyle, business coach, author, speaker. His inner circle is Brian Tracy, Mark Thompson, many others. You've seen him, possibly seen him with Warren Buffett. So we're really excited to have him here on the show to talk to us about this brand new book, all about transformations, profit, purpose, and many other things. So Steve, welcome to the show.
Thank you so much for having me, Steve.
Thank you so much for the book.
You're welcome.
I was excited to read it when I started going, okay, I gotta get on that.
You're welcome.
So tell us, what was your motivation behind writing the book?
Yeah, you know, I've actually wanted to write a book for a long time. Back when I was a CEO of a company and running a prudential real estate for many years, I used to have a lot of speakers, writers, and authors come in and speak to my sales team or my management team. So I started meeting a lot of people that were in that space, and I thought, someday I'm going to write a book, someday. And then I went on from being a CEO of a company to running my own real estate company. And when I phased out of that 2 years ago and started a consulting company, I thought, what a great way to finally have all the excuses gone, and to get the book launched. So it became a cathartic process, and it also then became a launching ground for me to market my new business that I have. So it became a very expensive calling card, if you would, in time and money to get it done. But I've been wanting to have this out of me to get this thing about transition and transformation out for quite some time.
So transition and transformation, talk about that as it relates to the book. I think that's very, very important, especially when people are making changes, whether to be moving into retirement or, you know, now in a position where we see a lot of people being downsized and they're in their mid-50s, late-50s, and they're looking at something new. How do they deal with those obstacles and that transition that goes along with that?
Well, I know that's your specialty. You help people do that all the time and transition to the next best spot. So it's a great question. Well, you know, I have been someone who's been really researching and looking at transition my entire life, from whether it was health issues that I had myself, whether it was financial issues, business career things. I've always been fascinated about the power of choice and the power that we have as human and spiritual beings to change our life. So I've always been into self-development and self-improvement. And when I started my consulting company, I chose the name Alchemy Advisors. And I love the word alchemy just because it represents transition and transformation. I love the book The Alchemist by Paulo Coelho. If you haven't read it, it's a great, phenomenal. It's not a business book. It's a fable about life and our journey. But the thing I find with all of us is that we're all in some type of transition. We're transitioning from one relationship to another. We might be transitioning in graduation time. I went to 4 graduations in the last week. So these young men and women are graduating to the next part of their life. They're in transition. When I was in corporate America, I sometimes transitioned from job to job within a company. And you know, at one point in a big part of my career, I was fired after a big, long path, and I was in a forced transition. So I've always been fascinated about whether it's chosen transitions or forced transitions, what we can do to take control of that and turn it into something that's much better and not be barraged with fear, because so many of us get bogged down in fear that we can't move forward.
Now, talk about some of the things that people could do. So, for example, like I said before, I have a number of clients that have been clients for a very, very long time. They've been at the top of their career, and you know what? A product decides to go this way with the company, and they go, oh, you know what? We don't need this division anymore.
Right.
And now they're in their mid-50s, and they're going, hey, you know what?
Now it's
getting really hard for me to find a job like I used to. I just used to put out a resume, be no problems.
Yes.
So how do people figure that out? What's the steps that they should take?
You know, I'm a big believer of everyone having a business and a life plan. Many of us have talked about having business plans. If you work within companies or corporations, or even if you're an entrepreneur, you probably ought to have some kind of business plan to get started. But very few of us have a life plan. And I know you have a life plan when you help people do their investments and their insurances and their different options, but also a life plan on your life for your family and your personal mission. So one of the things I help people do is find out what their mission is in life, not just what the next job is. What is it really is inside their heart and soul that's really calling them to do? And I believe that all of us have this nudging on our shoulder and this pulling at our collar that sometimes we just ignore because it's safe to stay doing what we're doing. So if you're in a forced transition or you're in a chosen transition, I help people to create business and life plans. It's a step-by-step process to help them to figure out what is your mission, what is your purpose, what are your core values, and then what are the steps to get there. So if you're going to eat an elephant, which not many of you eat an elephant, but if you're going to eat an elephant, you do that one bite at a time. But you have to have the vision first of what's possible. So if someone is looking to make a transition, I would sit down and say, hey, let's look at your big picture about what that looks like and then back into it to see if it's possible to make that a new reality. And it may be that it's no longer going in the workforce. The world of being an entrepreneur in this day and age with technology and working from home and the internet has leveled the playing ground in such a great way that allows people to start businesses that they never thought possible 5 or 10 years ago. So there's a whole new world out there.
I think that's great. And I just want to say one thing. A lot of people don't know this about me, but 10 years ago, I went through colon cancer.
I remember you and I talked about
it.
It was
devastating. My wife, you know, it was really tough on her.
Yes.
But one of the biggest things that came to me was, you know what? My goal was to make sure people that I was able to help never went through the same things I went through. And some of that is simple as making sure people have trust and have backup plans in case they go through something like that or have health issues. You know, I dealt with a client this morning, and I'm just sharing this because it's right along the same line, is, you know what, her husband went through 7 years of long-term care where she took care of him.
Ah, she was a caregiver.
But one of the things that we did with her is we made sure somebody can give her a break so she can have a life.
Yes.
And her husband just passed away 3 days ago.
Oh, wow.
And her son flew down from, the Seattle, Washington area, and we just had a wonderful conversation today. And she goes, I'm just so thankful that you showed me the way to make sure that I could do this without, you know, me losing my head and being in the same position of my husband because it was just so overwhelming.
Yes.
And
what a great gift you provided her.
Well, actually, you're providing that same gift too.
Yeah.
And that's what I really want to tell people is the gift that you provide is helping people get through those tough times and learn how to prosper as opposed to languish.
Opposed to being overwhelmed. Well, as you mentioned, it's interesting you should mention the health issue. What prompted me to finally start my consulting company is my wife almost 2 years ago had an unexpected health issue that she ended up in the hospital. She was in a coma for 3 weeks. She almost died for the first 3 days. And it really caused us both to assess our path, our life, and what do we really want to do with our lives. And so I really got into saying, okay, I'm no longer going to be running a residential real estate company that I've been doing for 20 or 25 years for myself or others. And I said, it's time for me to find my passion. And I got my wife aligned with that, and she was supportive of that once her health got back on track. And so I went out and decided to create. So people that have, whether they're health caregivers like you talked about, if they're in marriages or relationships, or they're in challenges of jobs, people like you and I that say, hey, there is another path. There is another way. And the key is to have people have enough confidence to understand it's possible and then to create the plan to help get the steps to do there. Because what happens is it makes everyone else around them more happy and more productive. When you are the caregiver or you are the provider or you are the breadwinner, the more fulfilled you are and the more happy you are with your life and your purpose and what you're doing, the more you're going to spread that around to your family and friends and associates around you.
Mm-hmm. And I, you know what, one of the things that I found when you're able to do this is, you know, everybody has those little quibbles with people.
Yes.
They all seem just to go away.
Yes.
It doesn't make a difference anymore. Those little things don't matter because it's not part of the big scheme.
That's true.
And when you can live in a place like that, that's a wonderful place to be in.
Yeah, absolutely. When people ask me what are the biggest things they can do to get started, sometimes I shock them and I say, find out who you need to forgive today. You know, who is it in your life right now? That it's mother, brother, sister, father, friend, employer, that you need to forgive, or who needs to forgive you? Because a lot of times what you're talking about, these quibbles that we have, it's unexpected, it's unused energy, that we're sometimes spending time being mad at someone or being focused on someone that's taking so much energy from us in our thought or action. Just the power of forgiveness alone can really put enough energy in your reservoir tank to finally get to that next level. You'd be amazed what happens with that one major big thing you can do.
This is wonderful. Hey, Steve, you know what? I'm a big advocate of listening to books. Is your book coming out on audio?
Thanks for asking. That's a good question. Actually, I'm in the last 2 hours of doing my Audible book. So I have a friend who owns an audiobook company. So we have worked out a relationship. And so he's taping it, and it'll be ready to go on Audible and a few other audio online services in the middle of July. And it's on Amazon right now in book format.
Thanks, Steve. That was wonderful information.
My pleasure.
If you would like to get Steve's book, Led to Gold, you can go to Amazon, or you can go to the Silver-Haired Tsunami website to get more information and links to getting the book. If you'd like to get a hold of Steve, you can do it through thealchemist.com. And stick with us. We'll be right back.
Hi, my name is Chuck Cassidy. I live in the Meadowview area of Temecula, and I chose Baker Electric Solar. Everybody and his brother is selling and installing solar these days, and you really have no way of knowing, are you going to get what you pay for? My electric bill has been in the minus every month for the past 2 years. Very few things in life these days come out the way you want. This was one of them.
Hello, welcome back. This is Steve Sexton. I have Paula Shaw, our transition therapist. Now, we're going to talk about sugar. We're going to talk about working out. We're going to talk about, oh, geez, watching too much TV, exercise, all those things. But it's not what you think. It's about addictions. And it's affecting people. And we've got Paula here to help us about it.
Now, hi, Steve.
Welcome to the show. I'm actually really looking forward to this because I've seen people who are addicted to having plastic surgery. okay? Mm-hmm. And they got way too much money, and they've sucked the fat out of their ankles the whole shot, okay? I was thinking about this, and I go, you know what? I just went through one of those big old tubs of licorice in the last 4 days when I was on vacation.
Ooh.
And, you know, I could be there, okay? And you know what? When I look at this, I said, you know what? Is it mommy see, mommy do? What's the situation when it comes to how big is the problem of this with baby boomers? And how does it affect their kids? Or are the kids going to have a bigger problem? You know, how does that all play in?
Wow, great question, Steve. Well, first of all, it is a big problem with baby boomers. I think for one simple, well, there are many reasons. I won't say one simple reason, but one of the big ones is boredom. You know, a kind of a loss of identity, a loss of purpose. What do I do now if I'm retired? Now, not all baby boomers are retired, but I think as we grow older, we're dealing with a lot of different kinds of losses. You know, I kind of frame a lot of things through that lens of loss, because having written that grief book, and I look at all the losses we experience in life every day, we're having some kind of loss, maybe many ones, but there are a lot of losses. So let's look at some of the losses that baby boomers are dealing with. Loss of appearance, like the woman you were talking about. I assume it's a woman.
Well, having... I have loss of hair, so.
Loss of hair, that's right. You know, loss of how we looked when we were young. Loss of our abilities to do all the things we used to do, feel the way we used to feel. And this career thing is a biggie. Once we retire, we don't have that same identity we had before. We don't have the same routine in our day. We don't have that same sense of purpose. And you don't usually have quite as strict a schedule. So it's so much easier to pour a cocktail at 3 instead of maybe 6 after work. Mm-hmm. It's a lot easier to fall into a habit of lunch and wine with the girls, you know, that kind of thing. And it sneaks up on people. And before they know it, they are addicted. Now, I'm just looking at alcohol in that analogy, but you brought up sugar, exercise, work. You know, we can be addicted to anything, and here's the bottom line. All addiction really has one purpose, and that is to distract us from our emotional pain. We don't want to feel that sadness or that fear or that anxiety that we're feeling because our lives are changing, or because something's going on that we don't feel good about. So have a drink or two, or take a prescription med, or, you know, go run for the second time at the gym, or go shopping. Mm-hmm. You know, there's so many things we can do to avoid our pain.
Or eating, or getting on the next diet program, or going to have another surgery.
Absolutely.
Or in my case, another Oreo.
And one of the real problems with the eating thing is, you know, abstinence is one way to try to heal an addiction, right? You know, you don't drink mm-hmm. anymore, or you don't smoke anymore, but you have to eat every day. So that one is really insidious. It's really difficult for people.
Now, let's talk about this. You know what? Does AA really work?
AA really does work for certain people.
Okay.
For other people, it doesn't work as well. There are a couple of things. You know, my clients often say they don't like the idea that they have to say words that say they're powerless. It's part of what people do in AA meetings. I'm powerless over my addiction. You know, and we know in recent research that words have power. There's an energetic vibration to words, and it impacts us. So I personally don't like a word like powerless myself. But I think if you can reframe it in your own mind, and this is probably why it works for some people, you're powerless in this arena. You're powerless to pick up that drink and drink it in moderation mm-hmm. or eat the sugar in moderation. And so if you reframe that properly in your own mind, that word's not such a problem. Other people don't do well because they just don't want to bear their dirty linen, so to speak, yeah. in a public setting. And yet, the group energy is one of the reasons AA is very powerful. It can be really helpful for that reason.
That's good to know. Now, here's one of the other thoughts. You know what? You heard of tough love, and we see this happen with a lot of teenagers, and, you know, does it really work?
Well, my motto is kind of like, tough love is tough on everybody. It's like, let's say we're parents and we have a child or a kid, a teenager, mm-hmm. who's acting out and who's doing some kind of drug or alcohol to excess. Who's going to suffer the most? If you tell that kid, you either have to stop drinking or you can't live here anymore. Okay, maybe the kid is now out on the street, but how does mom and dad sleep at night, not knowing their child is safe? I mean, it's agony. If you have to take a tough stand with anyone in your life, whether it's an adult or your child or whatever, it's equally tough on you, I think. You know, when you love mm-hmm. somebody, you want them to be safe.
Now, okay, what's the biggest myth about addiction and substance abuse?
I think the biggest myth, people have such a misconception. A lot of times they think people who are addicted are either weak or they're, I don't know, you know, like lower class people or that sort of thing. That isn't true at all. A lot of people who suffer addictions are some of the loveliest, most creative, kind, sensitive human beings out there, but doing the drugs or the alcohol or whatever they do helps buffer them from their pain. A lot of times they're some of the bravest, most brilliant, creative people out there. So that myth that they're weak or they don't try hard enough or they just don't care, I think is really untrue. Really
Paula,
untrue.
Thank you so much for sharing this light.
Yes.
It's wonderful. I want you to stick around for next week as well if you could. Now, if you'd like to get more information or even, you know, get a copy of Paula's book, The Grief, When Will the Pain Ever End? Please go to our website at The Silver Hair Tsunami. But next week, this is our July 4th episode. It's very important for people who might be dealing with it or dealing with addiction to get some help. That's why we're bringing in the Clinical Addiction Recovery Institute. It's a wonderful organization. They're going to be able to help us with all this. Stick with us. We'll be right back.
Hi, my name is Steve, and this is my wife, Amy. We just had our solar panels installed by Baker Electric. Living out here in the East County, the temperatures can be in the mid-70s to over 100.
We didn't know a lot about solar. Speaking with our solar consultant, he was there to answer any of our questions that we had. He was always there when we needed him.
I think the fact that Baker does go in-house with their employees, everyone is very professional and very polite, and they're on budget. We couldn't have gone with a better company.
My name's Kevin Grangetto. I live in Escondido, California, and I had my system put in by Baker Electric Solar. When they got here, they were ready to go. Started early, 6 in the morning. They parked off-site, so they were able to get everything in, on the roof, hooked up, and done in a matter of 3 days. And it was really easy for my wife and I to work with them. You just don't want a lot of these challenges to be, you know, affecting the way that you do your life. And when they got in and out of here, it was excellent. It was easy. It's just the way they told me it would be.
You know what? We had a wonderful show. We had Steve Rogers talk about his book, Lead to Gold. And you know what? It can make a big difference in your life. You want to go get that book. Two, we had Glen and Shannon of the Alliance Group talk about how to properly market a home from multiple different angles to make sure you get the most amount when you sell your property. And three, oh my gosh, we had Paula Shaw, the transition therapist, talk about addiction. You know what? Will make a difference in your life. If you would like more information, go to the Silver Hair Tsunami website. Check us out on Facebook. We'll see you next week.